Welcome back to Aliens. My name is Devin Reddy, and in this video, we'll talk about Node.js. So we'll talk about what is Node.js and why it is getting so famous. To understand this, let's start from somewhere else. See, let's talk about JavaScript first. And we all know JavaScript is one of the best languages available nowadays, right? So we have so many options, right? We have Java, Python, JavaScript. Of course, there are other languages as well. But then JavaScript is getting that edge. So you can find the JavaScript in top three languages. But why? Let's go back to 1995 when JavaScript was created. Now, JavaScript is going to complete its 25 years, right? So in 1995, when JavaScript was created, it was basically a web browser language, which simply means a client-side language. So JavaScript was used only on the client side, on the browsers, right? And all the other languages like Java was released in the same year. But then the other languages like, let's say, Python or C, C++, they were used everywhere on the machine side. That means you can use these languages for the standalone application. You can use these languages for the web applications, or the server-side applications, right? But if you talk about JavaScript, it was a browser language. And so if you want to build a website, you can use HTML for designing, you can use CSS to make it more attractive, and you can use JavaScript to make it more interactive. And that was the only use of JavaScript way back, right? So, and that's why I was not much interested in JavaScript, because I was not into the front-end part. I was more into the back-end services. How JavaScript as a programming language? Okay, so first of all, HTML and CSS is not a programming language. A lot of people think that, but JavaScript is actually a programming language which works on the browser. So how exactly you can run a programming language on a browser? So of course, right, it's a language which has to be converted into a language which can be understood by computer or the machine. And that's where we have an engine in between. So JavaScript as a language, as a developer, we write code, right? We develop the application in JavaScript, which will work on the browser, of course. And the browser has to interpret. Browser has to convert that code into machine. And that's where we have a concept of JavaScript engine. Now, JavaScript engine will convert your JavaScript code and will put it into machine code. Okay, maybe with the help of compiling or with the help of interpreter. Okay, but do we have only one JavaScript engine? No, that's not the case. We have multiple browsers, right? We have Chrome, we have Firefox, we have we used to have Netscape, and now we have Safari, we have Opera. So when you have all these browsers available, they use different engines. They use different JavaScript engines. Now it's their choice which one to use, right? Now, the first engine was SpiderMonkey. So SpiderMonkey was developed at Netscape, basically, by the creator of JavaScript itself, right? And it was developed in 10 days. So the entire JavaScript language with the compiler or with the engine was developed in 10 days. That's great, right? So Netscape was using SpiderMonkey. But then we got some other engines as well. Now, since we have different browsers, now one of them is Internet Explorer. It was using Chakra. And then we got Chrome. So after so many years, we got Chrome. Now Chrome has built their own JavaScript engine, which is called V8. Or Microsoft Edge is rebuilt using Chromium-based browser. So basically, it uses V8 now. So V8 became the most popular JavaScript engine. So yes, we have SpiderMonkey, which is still famous. We have V8, and then we have other engines as well. In fact, if you can just Google the JavaScript engines, you will see a list there, and you can just explore them. But the most famous now is V8. But why V8 got so famous? It's because V8 was converting the code directly into a machine code, which makes it much faster. It was having some internal components which was making the JavaScript engine faster. And that's where some people thought, hey, now JavaScript is getting faster. So JavaScript processing is getting faster. Can we use JavaScript not just in browsers, but everywhere? Now, since JavaScript was easy, we had a big community of JavaScript. Now, can we use JavaScript everywhere? And that was the question, right? So they thought, can we use JavaScript for mobile application? Can we use JavaScript for desktop applications? Can we use JavaScript for server? Of course, not the entire community was thinking in that way. Can we use JavaScript on the server? But then someone thought, hey, let's try it. And that's where they used V8 to build a runtime environment which will work on the machine, okay? And that they named it as Node.js. Now, Node.js is not a programming language, it's not a framework. It's basically a runtime environment where you can run JavaScript. So using Node.js, you can run JavaScript on a standalone machine, not on the browser, but on a physical machine. Now, using Node.js, you can build standalone application. I mean, that's awesome, right? And then some people thought, hey, can we use JavaScript for mobile application? Yes, and that's where we got some frameworks which using which you can build applications on mobile. So basically cross-platform applications, you can build the same application which works on iOS, which works on Android. Now coming back to Node.js, so Node.js is a JavaScript engine which runs your JavaScript on a physical machine, right? Okay, but then what if we can just add a HTTP component or HTTP module inside Node.js? That means the moment you have that HTTP power, you can use Node.js on the server side. And that's what we got. We got Node.js, which has a lot of different modules. Some are inbuilt, some you can download from the internet. So we have a big community now. They build these modules and you can use them. And one of the module is HTTP. Now, that means you can use Node.js as a server-side component. So JavaScript can be used on the browser. JavaScript can be used on the server side. And that's where we have a concept of full stack development, right? So in full stack, we have front end, we have back end, then we have the database as well. Now you can do everything with the help of JavaScript. So front end, we had JavaScript before, and thanks to the new frameworks, we have React, we have Angular. So that's the front end, which takes care of the front end. Then we have the back end, which is Node.js runtime environment. But hold on, do we have the framework to build web applications? Now, if you're coming from the Java background, we have Spring Web, right? We have Spring MVC. If you're coming from, let's say, Python, we have Django. What framework do we use in JavaScript? So Node.js is not a framework, right? So we have to use some framework. And that's where we got Express.js, or Express in short. So we got Node.js, which is the server-side runtime. We got Express.js, which is the framework for developing web applications. And then we have the front-end frameworks, which is Angular or React. And we can use MongoDB as a database. So we can use Mean or Mern stack to build the entire web application from start to end using one language, which is JavaScript. And that's the reason JavaScript is getting so famous now. And that's the reason why Node.js is getting so famous. In fact, Node.js has one more thing called NPM, which is Node Package Manager. Now, if you're coming from Java background, since I'm from Java background, I can take more examples of it. In Java, when you build an application, you use some external dependencies. Let's say in your application, you want to use some database. You need some connectors in between. Maybe you want to work with files. You want to use image compressor. You want to use video converters. So you can use those jar files, right? You can use those dependencies. Luckily, in Node.js, we have a concept of NPM, which gives you all those packages, which gives you all those modules, right? So they have the huge database of modules. You can use them. You can build your own modules as well. And that's the reason why Node.js is so powerful. So just to reiterate, what is Node.js? Node.js is a JavaScript runtime environment, which uses the V8 JavaScript engine. Okay, maybe in future we'll be having all the browsers working on V8. It is that powerful. So if you love Node.js, so you have to thank first JavaScript developers. They have to thank Google as well, because they have given you V8. And of course, you have to thank the Node.js team. Welcome back, aliens. My name is Levin Reddy, and in this video, we'll see how to install Node.js and Visual Studio Code on Windows machine. Now see, you can do this code on different OS. If you are using Linux or Mac or Windows, it works on all the systems. So Node.js and VS Code works on all different platforms. And first of all, if you want to continue with the series, if you want to see the basics of Node.js, you can use any IDE which you prefer. I will be using VS Code, which works perfectly for Node.js, so you can use that. And it also has some extensions you can use. Now, first, need to verify in your system, do you have Node.js? See, the thing is, when you work on some projects or when you install some softwares, there might be a chance that those projects or the softwares need Node.js as a dependency. So maybe in your machine, you might be having Node.js by default. So how do you verify? So you can just go to CMD or your command prompt, maybe terminal or command prompt. And here, you can simply search for Node V, which is version. So if it is giving you the version, that means Node is installed. So you can continue with that. Otherwise, it will show Node is not recognized. So that's perfect, right? So in this machine, I don't have Node. Now the thing is, even if you have Node installed in your machine, it might be an old version. and we want to work on the new versions, right? At least the second last version, not the latest. So let's install Node, or let's upgrade Node if you have. So the best option is, if you already have Node in your machine, just remove it so that you can do a fresh installation. So what we will do is, to install Node, let's go to the official website of Node.js. So let's go to browser and search for Node.js, and it will give you a list of websites. And of course, we need to go to the official one, which is nodejs.org. And if you can go there, before installation, I just want to show you the website. It tells you a lot of things. The first thing it says is Node.js is a JavaScript runtime, okay, so which we have talked about this in the earlier video, built on Chrome's V8 JavaScript engine. So it is built on V8, as we have discussed. And if you go to the about a section of Node.js, you can see it gives you a sample example. It explains the concept it supports, why it is event driven, why it is asynchronous, and you can have a look at those things. But we want to go to the back to the home, and you can see we have an option of download for Windows. Now, depending upon what OS you have, if you're using Linux, Mac, and Windows, it works on all the different OS. And if you can just click on the downloads tab, it will give you different options. There are two things actually here. One is LTS and second is current. LTS is long-term support. Whenever you go with the LTS version, that means it will having a longer support. We want to go for the current one. And while you're learning, you can choose any one, right? You can choose LTS or you can choose current one. But yes, when you are going for a production software, when you are building the real projects, then you have to think about these versions. Now, when you click on current, of course, depending upon which OS you have, you can choose. I'm using Windows and 64-bit, so I'll be using 64-bit MSI. So you can just click on this and it will download the Node.js for you. So as you can see, I have the Node.js set up in my machine, and we just have to install this. Now, how do you install it? It's very simple, right? You just have to double-click it, and it will give you some options. You have to say next. We don't have a choice. We have to accept the agreement. Say next, and this is a path you have to mention. Of course, the default works. Say next. Nothing much here. It says add to the path. Yes, it will be adding to the path. Let's do that. Okay, now this is important. This is an important tab. So it says automatically install the necessary tools. Note that this will also install Chocolaty. Now, Chocolaty is a npm for Windows, and we have talked about npm before, right? So it's a very handy tool. So I would recommend you to tick this and say installation. It might take more time. So when you say tick, and it will download a lot of different tools for Node.js. And if you're serious about this, make sure that you have all those tools available with you. Say next and click on install. Yes. Now it will take some time for the installation. Now, as you can see, the setup is complete. You just have to click on finish. Now, since I'm doing this for the second time, it has not given me extra prompts, which I got in the first installation. So you might get those prompts about installing the Chocolaty, and it will take more space. So you just have to say yes and click on install. Now, once you click on finish, you can see, oh, it is still continuing. But that's the prompt I was talking about. Okay, so it is downloading the extra tools. So first it will get the latest version of Chocolaty. And by the time it gets the installation, let's head towards the website of Chocolaty. So let's go to the website of Chocolaty. Now, if you search for Chocolaty, this is a website. So it's a package manager for Windows. So we can use this tool for the extra modules you want. Okay, so everything is done. It has installed the software. Click on enter. And I guess we have the setup ready now. But how do we verify this? And for this, you have to go back to your command prompt and say node v, and oh, it is still not installed. Maybe I have to restart my cmd command prompt. And let's say v, and you can see that we got the node version. So node version is 13.13, which is the current release. So you can use that. Okay, now once you got Node, and I mean, depend upon when you're watching this video, maybe after 1 year, you might be having a new version. So even if you have a new version, it might work. The thing is, it goes for three different releases, you know, three different version systems. In fact, we'll talk about that in detail later. But we have the bug fixes, so the last part will change depending upon the bug fixes. The middle part will change based on the minor increments. And the first part will change depending upon the major increments. And whenever you get a minor increment or patches, it will not change much in the system. But yes, if you have a major version, it might be having some new features. It might remove the old features. So you need to check those things as well. Okay, now once you got Node, of course, we want to write some code. We want to run the first code. Of course, whenever you learn a new language, a new framework, or a new tool, the first thing you do is you run Hello World. We want to do that here first. But of course, we'll not be doing that in this video, but we need some software for that. Where do you write your code? And for that, you need an editor. You can use Notepad as well, okay, but we'll be using some advanced editors, which is one of them is VS Code. In this machine, I do have VS Code. And if you want to install VS Code, just go to Google, search for VS Code. That's the website. Download the setup. It's very easy to install VS Code actually. Click on download for Windows and it will do the installation. Now how it looks like. So I do have the VS Code setup here. Let me open that. And that's how VS Code looks like, which is Visual Studio Code. This is where you can create folders, you can create files, and you can run it. In fact, you can use VS Code for all different programmings, for all different frameworks. It supports majority of them, so you can use it. So yeah, that's it from this video, where we have talked about how to install Node and how to install VS Code. In fact, we have not seen the installation of VS Code. You know how it works. So that's it from this video. In the next video, we'll see the first code. Or we'll write hello world, we'll do some addition of two numbers just to understand how this tool works. Welcome back, aliens. My name is Devin Reddy, and in this video, we'll start with Node.js. So we'll write our first code, and we all know, right, when you start a new language, a new technology, the first thing you want to check is by printing hello world. That's the inauguration of that technology, right? Even when you work on blockchain, the first thing I do is I print hello world. Okay. Anyway, so let's write a code to print hello world on the console. So when I say console, I'm not talking about browser console. I'm talking about the command line. So we will write a JavaScript code which will run, and it will print the output on the terminal of your machine or CM or the command prompt. That's interesting, right? So not just that, we'll also see how to add two numbers so that we can see that we can write JavaScript code and you can add two numbers just to start with the code. Okay. So that's not our intention to learn how to add two numbers, but our intention is to check, can we print hello world? Can we add two numbers? And then we'll build a simple HTTP service. See, what happens is when you talk about Node.js, it is very famous in the world of backend development, right? And we need to see some code. Of course, that's not the code which we write on the person server, but at least we can get started. So without any ado, let's get started. So I will open my Visual Studio Code. This is an IDE we are going to use. You can use any IDE which you prefer. In this, let me create a, so let me just go to a terminal and let's do all this thing in a particular folder. So in my terminal, I will simply, first of all, let me just increase size of the terminal. So in this terminal, I will say, let me create a simple folder, and we'll name this folder as, let's say, Node X, Node Examples. And let's switch to this particular folder. And in this folder, I want to get a file. Now, how do we do that? So just click here and let's create, we have to open that folder first. So open folder. Okay, that's our folder. Click on select folder. And here you will see your folder is open. Let me close that. Now in this particular folder, which is Node X, I want to create a file. See, the name of the file is not important. What is important is the extension. Now, since we are working with Node.js, where JS is JavaScript, so the extension has to be JavaScript here. So let me create a file name called as app.js. You can go for any file name. This is a very common name. Now, the only thing I want to do here initially is I want to print hello world, right? So how do we do that? Do we have to get any functions? If you are coming from other languages like C, C++, Java, we have this habit of getting functions, right? But here we can run this script directly, so we can directly run the code, which is console.log, the same code which you write on the browsers. And here I will print hello world. Nothing more, just hello world. And what do you think, will it work? First of all, how do we run this code? So we have written the code, it's time to run it, right? So let's go back to terminal. And I'm in this terminal now, and I want to run this code. Now, the way you can do that is by saying node, that's the command you have to pass, and the name of the application, which is app.js, which is the file. Click on enter and you can see we got hello world. So that's right, we can write our first hello world code like this. The next thing I want to check is how do you add two numbers? Because this is where you will use variables, right? And we all know JavaScript is a programming language, so it should work here. But just to check how that works, let me just create three variables. I will say var, we can also use let is the better way. But let me use var here, var equal to 7 and var b is equal to 2. So that's those are the two variables I have. I want to add these two, so I will say c is equal to a plus b. A very simple calculation. And here I want to print the output is, and let me print c. That's it. And you have a choice of using a semicolon. If you can skip it, that's your choice. If you're coming from Java background, you want to use a colon there, a semicolon. If you are coming from, let's say, Python, you want to avoid it. So JavaScript has both the options. In fact, the same option is there with Python as well. So I will say enter, and you can see the output is 9. So this works. So you can print hello world, you can add two numbers. But now I want to do something else. And that something else is I want to create a simple HTTP service in Node.js. See, Node.js is famous for web development, right? So, I mean, of course, if you are running Node.js, maybe that's your target to learn web development and build backing services. Now, for that, you have to first understand what is web service or what is web applications. See, you have a client, which is your browser, and then you have a web service, which will be on a server. Now, this server need to have a unique IP address. Normally, whatever server you access, maybe it may be google.com, I mean, Google server or Facebook server, every server will have the IP address. And the only way to reach there is with the help of IP address. But then we don't know about the IP addresses, right? When you go to Google, you don't mention the IP address. What you mention is the domain name. And then we have some DNS servers in between. They will manage this naming conversion. So when you say google.com, they will send requests to a particular IP address. So we have the entire table there. So basically, if you want to access any service or any server, you need to enter the IP address. But then one server can have multiple services, right? So HTTP is one of the service. Maybe you want to access the FTP service. Maybe you want to access the SMTP service. So every service will have a different port number. So let's say we have a server. Maybe we have multiple servers. Every server will have the different IP address. And each server will have multiple services. And how can you differentiate between these services is with the help of port number. So if you want to reach to a HTTP service or a particular server, you have to mention two things. The first thing you have to mention is the IP address, then you have to mention the colon, and then you have to mention the port number. So whatever service we will create, we have to do both. We have to go for the IP address when you want to run this, and then you have to also mention the port number. Okay, that looks fun. Let me just remove this. So this is empty. I will save this. And I will go back to my browser because that's where I want to run this code, right? So I will just right click on my Chrome, and here I will say new community mode. Here I will enter the IP address which I want to hit. So the service is on the same machine, right? So I can go with this address, or you can also mention localhost, that's your choice. But then only doing this will not work. You have to also mention the port number, right? So I will say colon, and then you have to mention the port number. But which port number I will be using? So you can, if you go for any tutorial online, they will prefer 9000, but since I'm coming from Java background, I have worked on Apache Tomcat, which by default gives you 8080. And for me, it makes much more sense to use this port number, but that's your choice. You can use any port number which you want. You can also use 8001 or 8876. That's your choice, right? But use something which is easy to remember, and 9000 is easy to remember. Some people use 3000. But let's go with 8080. I love that port number. And when I say enter, so you can see we got 404. That's the code. Now we got error because we don't have this service running. So let's create a service. So let's go back to Visual Studio, and here I want to get a service. So how will you do that? Actually, it's very simple. You just have to use a function called create server. Now create server is a function which will give you a service, which will create a service for you, or which will get a server for you. And this server takes a function. So whenever you call this server, it will execute a function. And let me say function. Now, if you're coming from JavaScript, you know what I'm talking about. But we are passing a function inside a function. And this function will accept two parameters. Now, the first parameter is something which you received from the client. And then the second parameter is something you want to send to the client, right? So when you have a client-server architecture, a client sends a request and server sends a response. So you need two objects here, request and response. There was extra semicolon there. Let me complete that here. Okay, so we got a function here, and then this function will do something. So we have to send the response back to the client, right? Now, how do we send a response back to the client? So for that, you have to say res dot, and you have to mention a function which is right. And in this double quotes, you have to mention something. So let's say I want to print welcome back alien. That's it. I just want to return this on the browser. But will this work? Let's try. So let's go back to our command line, and here I will say node app.js, but we got an error. It says create server is not defined. Oh, that's weird. We are defining it here, right? The thing is, create server is a function which you are calling, right? So we have to mention where this create server exists. So we have to call it from somewhere. So create server is a function available in a module called HTTP. Now, what is module? See, when you talk about JavaScript or when you talk about a Node.js, it has multiple modules available. Now, some of the modules are inbuilt and some of the modules which you can create. So it helps you to achieve a concept of modularity, where you can have different components working together. So let's say if you want to build the application, connect these three modules, build an application, something like making a pizza. Right, just mix it up and you will get something new. So we have to use a module, and the module name is HTTP. Now, how do you include that module? How do you fetch that module? Now, for that, you have to first create a variable, let's say HTTP, and you have to accept the module, right? So for that, you have to use a function called require. And in this require, you can mention the module name, which is HTTP. So you have to mention require function, and you're saying, hey, I want HTTP module, which you can save here in HTTP. Now, this name can be anything, doesn't matter, but it makes sense to use this. Now, once you got your module, okay, we got some warning here. It says remove declare. Okay, because we are not using that HTTP yet. So let's use it. So here in this create server, if you want to call create server, you have to use http.createServer, because create server belongs to HTTP. Our job is done. Let's try now. Let's go back to our terminal. Let me just clear the terminal first. And let me say node app.js enter. Okay, something happened. You can see there is no error now. And if I go back to the browser and if I say refresh. Okay, so you can see it is trying to connect and we got 404 again. That's weird. So what went wrong? See, the thing is, we have created this server, but then we have not mentioned the port number. So this server has to listen to the port number, which is 8080. And to do that, you will simply say listen after this bracket, after this function, you have to say dot listen and mention the port number 8080 and simply say save. I hope this will work this time. Let's go back and say node app.js. Okay, there's no error. And this time you can see you're not even getting the next prompt. It is simply is waiting for your work to be completed. Let's go back to the browser and say refresh. I hope this will work. Okay. Something is not working. Okay, what went wrong? So go back to our code. See, when you say res.write, you're saying welcome back aliens. What if I say this is working? Okay, so this is ready to send the welcome back alien to the client, but it is not sending it. The thing is, you may want to send multiple statements, right? It's not just one statement. If you look at the browsers and if you go to any website, you will see multiple strings, you have multiple content. Some are images, some are strings, some are text, or some are numbers. So you want to send all those things together. But in this case, I'm simply saying one statement. So my server is actually waiting for more statements. But we have to inform the server, hey, that's the end. I don't want to send anything else. So you have to also mention end at the end. So when you don't want to send anything more, just say end. After doing the changes, let's restart the app. Let's go back here and we got the output. So as you can see, we got the output as welcome back alien. And that's how it works, right? So we have to say end. We have to mention end here. Otherwise, if you just want to send one statement, instead of using end, you can actually write end here. That works. In fact, you can also mention the header. See, when you send a response, it's always better to have, of course, you can send the data, but also send the header information. Maybe something like the status. So whenever you get the response, you have to send status 200. When you get error, you can send status in 400s. So Ford not for is file not found, and then there are different type of headers as well. Now how do you send the header? So you can say res dot, you have to say write head, and in this bracket you have to mention two things. You can mention the status and you can also mention the content type you want to send. So the content type I want to send is, okay, so I will say content type txt slash html. So basically we are saying whatever I'm sending is of type HTML and text HTML. Sometimes you want to send the data in JSON format. So you can mention the JSON format there, or you can mention XML format there. So that's your choice what you are sending. And if you are coming from other languages like Python, Java, you do the same thing there as well. You mention the content type when you work on the web service. So yeah, that's it from this video where we have seen how do you get started with Node.js, creating a simple hello world code, then addition of two numbers, and then seeing a simple web service. Welcome back, aliens. My name is Levin Reddy, and in this video, we'll talk about how Node.js works. See, when you say Node.js, we can build the applications in JavaScript, which we can run everywhere, not just on web browsers. That's right. When JavaScript came into picture, it was mainly for the websites. So if you want to make your website interactive, that's where we have used to use JavaScript. And then it used to run on web browsers. But now we want to run JavaScript on desktops. We want to run JavaScript on mobile application and as a server as well. And that's right, we can build the backend applications in Node.js. So that means we can use Node.js as a backend server. But then how it works? To understand how Node.js works as a backend server, we have to first understand how web server works. See, when you say web server, it will be having a web application, right? And then that web application will be accessed by a client. Now this client can be a web browser, this client can be a mobile application. Now when you have a web browser, that means a web browser will be expecting a HTML page. But let's say if you are requesting this server with the help of mobile phone, that means you don't want the entire application, you just want the data. Example, let's say if you have a cricket score app on your mobile phone, now this app will have everything, the entire layout, but then what it will not have is the real-time data. So let's say there's a match going on, you want the real-time data. Now that data will be given by the server. So that means we have a server and then we will be having a client. Now in this case, let's say you have one client and this one client says, hey, I want the current status. That means I want to know the score of the match, the current score. Now in this case, the server will say, okay, I will give you data. But then from where the server will give you data? Maybe the server is requesting to some other server to get the data. Maybe the server is getting data from the database. Maybe the server is getting data from the file system. Now if this server is requesting to some other server or to a database, it will take some time, right? Maybe 1 second or 2 seconds or maybe half a second. See, if it is a very simple task, if you want to add two numbers, server will say, okay, that's your number. So if you want to add 2 plus 2, the answer is 4. But if it is an IO intensive work where a server is requesting to some other resources, that's a tricky thing, right? Because if you have one server which takes 3 seconds, that's tricky, right? Because if you have one client and one client take 2 or 3 seconds, what if you have multiple clients? What if you have 10 clients? If you get requests from 10 clients, that means to respond to the 10th client, it will take 30 seconds. I mean, that's weird, right? Who will wait for 30 seconds? How do you handle this? How do you handle multiple requests at the same time? Now, in this case, if you have different type of servers, example, if you talk about Java. Now, in Java, we use a Tomcat server. Now, if you don't know about Java, that's fine. Just try to understand the concept behind it. So Java is a language. If you want to build a web application, you need to use a server, which is Tomcat. Now, Tomcat will say, okay, see, I can handle multiple requests. Now, how it does that? You'll be having a concept of threads. So in the Tomcat server, you'll be having multiple threads. So every time a client sends a request, the Tomcat server will assign one thread to it. What if you get second request? You'll be having second thread. So if you have 10 requests, you'll be having 10 threads running in parallel. That means if a request takes 3 seconds, every client will take only 3 seconds, not 30 seconds. Okay, that's awesome, right? But then by default, Tomcat will provide you 200 threads. Oh, that means we can only have 200 clients. What if you have 210 clients? The last 10 clients will have to wait for 30 seconds or whatever seconds it is. But they have to wait, right? Because you have a limited number of threads. But then most of the cases, you can increase the system speed, right? But that's a different thing. So you'll be having multiple threads. Now coming back to Node.js, in Node.js, we run JavaScript, right? And JavaScript language don't have a concept of multiple threads. Oh, now how do we achieve that? Now, first of all, when Node.js was created, they had a choice, right? Either they can introduce the concept of threads inside JavaScript. Okay, but then it will lose the meaning of JavaScript, right? It will lose the real sense of JavaScript. So they went for the second option, which is let's not use threads. But then how will you handle multiple requests? So let's say if you are using a web server which is built using Node.js, and if you get a request, Node.js will say, okay, it's a very simple request, I can return it. Example 2+2, answer is 4. But what if the server is responsible to send a request to the other server and get the data? Now, in this case, when client 1 comes to the server, we'll say, hey, I want the current score. Now, in this case, Node.js will say, okay, I'm handling your request. Node.js will have only one thread. So that one thread has sent a request to the other server. It is waiting for the other server to respond. Maybe it will take 2 seconds. What if in that time you got another request from client 2? Now, client 2 has to wait for the client 1 request to get over. When client 1 request is over, then server will say, hey, client 2, it's your turn now. Client 2 will say, okay, I want the same thing. Maybe the football score, maybe some other game score. Now, in this case, server will take another 2 seconds or 3 seconds. What if in that time duration you have 100 requests? Of course, not everyone will wait. So is it flexible to use Node.js as a web server? Okay, but they have a solution for it. Okay, don't worry. So what Node.js says is, okay, I'm a single-threaded application. That means I can only accept requests. I can do that, right? So Node.js can handle multiple requests. But what Node.js will not do is waiting for the other server to respond. So the single thread will not be blocked for a one client or for a single client. Okay, but then how it will do it? How it will work? So Node.js uses two concepts. One is asynchronous and second is non-blocking I/O. Now let's focus on non-blocking first. Now what is non-blocking I/O means is whenever you get a request from a client, the single thread will send that request to someone else. The current thread will not be busy working with that request. Okay, so let's say we have some workers there who is working for this server. So Node.js will say, hey worker, I got a request, go to the server and get me the response. Worker will say, okay, I will do it. The second client comes and then the Node.js single thread is still open, right? It is still accessible. Second client will say, okay, I want this football score. The server will say, hey, second worker, go there and get me this score, right? Or get me data. That's how it works. So Node.js uses the concept of non-blocking I/O, which simply means it will not wait or it will not block itself for one request. Yeah, but then what if a client says, hey, I want to find a factorial of this number. And then it has multiple calculations. Now in this case, when you have multiple calculations, it's a complex task, right? Which has to be done by this thread. And that's where we don't normally prefer to use Node.js for CPU intensive work. We use Node.js mostly for the IO intensive. So whenever you want to interact with the external system, maybe database, maybe file system, or maybe network, that's where Node.js is so famous. But then we have one more question. What if client one sends a request to the server and then server says, hey worker, go and fetch data. And then this single thread is accessing the client two, right? Or working with client two. What if the request or the response of client one comes from the other server? How it will execute the remaining statements? And that's why we have a concept of asynchronous. We have a concept of callback. So the moment you get a response from the other server or from the database, you will execute a callback function. Okay, so that's why it is called asynchronous. You'll understand this more once you see the practical video. But then just to get the idea, we use a concept of asynchronous, which is using callbacks. And we have a concept of non-blocking I/O. Okay, but then we have one more question. If Node.js doesn't support multiple threads, how we are able to create these workers? Because maybe you will be having 100 workers. What are they if they are not threads? See, to implement this, Node.js uses a concept of libuv. Now, libuv is a special library built for Node.js, but then we can use it for other applications as well. It provides you a concept of non-blocking I/O. Now, it is built in C language, which uses the system kernel, and kernel has multiple threads. So in Node.js, you are not using multiple threads, but behind the scene, your kernel is implementing multiple threads. So these workers, which I'm talking about, are threads. So when you send a request to the server, Node.js, it will be single-threaded, but behind the scene, they are using multiple threads. And that's what makes Node.js fast and flexible. Welcome back, aliens. My name is Devin Reddy, and in this video, we'll talk about NPM. So I hope you are enjoying this series on Node.js, and one of the most important topic in Node.js series is NPM. NPM stands for Node Package Manager. But why do we need it? First of all, when you talk about Node.js, it is very famous, right? Now it is famous because it provides a lot of different features. One of them is non-blocking IO, which we'll talk about that later. And the other one is NPM, the package manager. See, what happens is, as a developer, when you build applications, when you build websites or whatever type of application you build, you need to use some external libraries. You have to use some external dependencies. See, you can do everything from scratch, right? You can write the entire application by yourself. But then we are living in a world where you need to do things faster. Plus, there are certain things which are already there, right? So example, if you want to find a way to connect with a database, right? So you can build an API which will help you to connect your application with a database. Maybe you want to do some validation for the objects. So let's say you have an object which has certain properties and you want to validate it. Now, one way to do that is by building a module by yourself which will validate your object. So those are the ways, right? So you can build everything by yourself. But then when you have a common task, when you have a common problem, since we have millions of developers and they are building the same thing which you are doing, so why can't we create a module which will be used by everyone? So let's say I'm solving a big problem. So what we can do is we can convert that into small problems, right? And then every problem or every solution will be one module. And maybe what I can do is I can push this module to the repository so that the entire world can use it, right? So when you build all the application, we'll be having some common features, right? So you can put that in modules. In the same way, when you talk about Node.js, Node has a lot of inbuilt modules. One of that we have already seen, which is HTTP. But what if you want to work with file system? We have a module for that. What if you want to work with cryptography? We have a module for that. So Node.js has some inbuilt modules. But what if you want extra modules? What if you want to use someone else's modules? And that's where we have a concept of NPM, which is Node Package Manager. Now, this concept is there in multiple languages. When I work on Java, we have libraries there. We have dependencies, so I can use that. So we used to use Maven there or Gradle to fetch that. But they have a different approach. Now, in terms of NPM, it has millions of packages available. That's right. So last year, when I saw the article, they have mentioned that last year they have completed 1 million packages on NPM. That's awesome, right? So that means when the moment you have a problem in your mind, there is a solution available, and that's the awesomeness about NPM. So basically, you can use all those packages. So you can just fetch them, install on your machine and use them. And you can also push your packages. So let's say if you have a module which you have created, so you can push that module to the GitHub and the entire world will use it. And that's awesome. Now let's go to the website of NPM to get more information. So this is the official website of NPM, which is npmjs.com. And the good news is NPM, okay, good news or bad news, I'm not sure, but NPM is now part of GitHub, and GitHub is now part of Microsoft. So you can see it says build amazing things using in JavaScript. So it will take you from somewhere to everywhere using NPM. That's what they promise. So it has multiple packages. We have to focus on the free one. So this is the NPM free one, which we are going to use. So come back here. Now, when I say it has millions of packages, how will you get those packages? Now, first of all, we need to search for the package. So let's say I want to do some socket programming. I can search for socket.io. Now, using socket.io, you can create real-time servers, real-time data sending. That's right. So you can see you can use this socket.io. And look at the weekly downloads. That's so famous, right? So it says around 15 million per month. That's huge number of usage. One of the package which we are going to use in this code is maybe MongoDB. We are going to use MongoDB for connecting to database. This is the official one, so you can use that. And soon we are going to use Express.js. Now, Express is a framework for web development in Node.js. So if I go back to Express, that's what it says. It says fast, unopinionated, minimalistic web framework for Node. Okay, we'll see that. This is a simple sample code. But then how will you get this module in your project or in your machine? That's where we have a concept of we have to execute this command, but where you will do it? Of course, you can do it in normal command prompt. But then if you remember, we were writing a code right before in the same terminal here, the thing which we have done before. That's the command you have to pass to check the npm version. So yes, when you install when you install Node.js, you will get npm as well. So here, if I want to install that, I will simply say npm install express. This is the command you have to execute to install packages, that's it. And once you install the packages, you can use that in your project. So it says installing Express. So it will take some time. But then after installation, how will you use it? The way you have used HTTP. Now HTTP is an inbuilt module in Node.js, and that's why we don't have to download it from NPM. So you can simply say require, and you can mention the module name. The same thing goes for Express. So just mention require Express, it will give you Express framework. And that's it, that's how you install it. I guess there's an error, no? Okay, so we got Express. So you can see in our modules folder, you will see Express here. That's right, so we got Express. But then we have only installed one package, right? Why we got all these other modules? So the thing is, when you want a module, maybe that module is dependent on some other modules. So that's what you say. So those are the secondary dependencies. So you want Express, Express wants all other modules. And that's why you got all the modules here. So likewise, you can download multiple modules the way just doing the same thing, right? One thing interesting here is if I go to Node.js and if I minimize this, or Node.x and minimize this, there's one more file which is package log.json. Again, we'll talk about that in detail later. So we have the log version, and then we can have also normal version which we can edit. Now this is where you mention what you need in your project, so which modules you need. So we have used Express, so let me just search for Express here. And you can see we are using Express version, which is 4.17.1. And it will give you the exact version. So there are different ways you can mention the version which you want to install. So when we installed NPM, when we installed Express, we have not mentioned the version. So if I go back to the website, so it should show you the version. You can see we got 4.17.1. But what if you want to use the earlier versions? How will you do that? So when you click on this versions tab, you can see all the older version. And if you want a specific version here, let's say if you want to go for 4.15.1, and if you want to install this dependency, then you have to mention the version number as well. So you can see we have a command here, which is npm. So you can also use I or install, that's your choice. You have to mention the name of the package and the version, which is 4.15.1. But there are other options as well. So what if you want the latest version, or you want the version above this version? So you can specify all those things using special symbols, which we'll see later when we talk about the packages in detail later. So that's how we can use the existing packages. But what if you want to create your own module? It's quite possible. You just have to get a module, which we'll see later how to create a module. But once you have your module ready with you, which you are using in your project, the same module you can publish on NPM, right? So everyone can use it. So let's see if I can make a video on that, how to publish your own modules. But as of now, we have understood what is NPM. NPM stands for Node Package Manager, which manages all your packages. So we have millions of packages available online. And if you are trying to solve a given problem, break down that problem, and one of the problem solution will be available in the packages. Not one, many actually. Welcome back, aliens. My name is Devin Reddy, and in this video, we'll talk about modules in Node.js. Now, one of the reasons why Node.js is so famous is because of NPM, right, which is Node Package Manager. And we have discussed about it, right? So last year, we got more than 1 million packages or modules on NPM. So that means we can use all those modules to build our application. But then what are modules? Now you can imagine modules as a small encapsulated units, which you can reuse, which you can share with everyone, and which are easier to maintain. Now, okay, so I know it is getting confused, right? Now think about this. We have a big application, or we have a big problem. Now to solve a big problem, the first step should be break down your big problem into small problems. And then each small problem will have a small solution. And we can name that small solution as a module, right? Or maybe you can just break that small modules into more small modules, and then you can have a small part. Now, the advantage of making that small part is it is easier to maintain because it has less code. It is easier to share, and it is easier to debug, right? So maintenance, debugging, and sharing is an important thing. Now, this concept is there in most of the languages or technologies, and this concept is called modularity, right? So you have to create small modules. So example, maybe you can create a module using which you can connect with database. You can create a module using which you can write data to the file. Maybe you can create a module which will be good for calculations. So maybe you can create a small module, calculation, which will have addition, subtraction, division, multiplication. And you can use this module in any of your project. You can share this module with everyone in this world and they can use it. Of course, for that, you just have to publish your module to the NPM. And even if you don't want to publish, you can reuse your own modules, right? So that's the thing. But now in Node.js, they have inbuilt modules. If you remember, in one of the videos, we have talked about HTTP module, which is an inbuilt module in Node.js. So if you want to use it, you just have to use a function called require. Likewise, we have multiple modules and you can use it. So basically, Node.js has some inbuilt modules. You can create your own modules as well. I know, that's exciting, right? And then you can use some third-party modules if you want from NPM. So in this video, our main focus would be how to create a module and how to use it. So we are not going to use any existing modules. We are not going to use any module from NPM, but let's create one. Now for that, let's create a small code. So we have app.js here, and I would just wanted to add two numbers. And then we have seen it, right? How to add two numbers. But in this case, I will be creating a function to add two numbers. So let's say I have console.log, and I just want to print the output. So I will say output is, and plus I will say result. Okay, I don't have this variable yet, but hold on. Let me get this variable. So I will say result is equal to. So I want to create a function which will give me the output. But which function? So let's call that function as add. And this will take two parameters. One is 4 and 5. And this return the result. Okay, so 4 plus 5 is 9, right? So this result should get 9. But hold on. Even if you try to run this code, so let's run this code. Let's see what happens. I will say app.js. You will get an error. It says add is not defined. That's right. We have this function. We are using this function. But where is defined? It's not an inbuilt function. And so basically, we have to create one. So let's create a function here. Now, how do we do that? You know, if you're familiar with JavaScript, it's very simple. Just a function, mention the function name, and you have to pass two parameters. I will say a comma b. And here, you just have to say return a plus b. That's how you add two numbers. Quite simple, right? Now, what do you think? Will it work? Let's try. Let's go back to our console and say app.js. It worked. You can see we got the output as well. It says the output is 9. So this is working. But then where is the module here? The thing is, whenever you want to perform operation and if you want to create a module, the best thing you can do is create a separate file. Because see, in this case, we just have one function. Maybe you have more functions. So you can put all those things in a separate file. Let me create one then. So let me just go back to my app. And here I will create maybe calc.js. That sounds better. Now in this calc, I just want to create this function. So I will go back here. I will say cut and I will paste it here. So basically, I have this function in a separate JS file, and I want to use it here. Now, will this work? Let's try. Let's see if this works. And if I say Node.js, we got the output. That's weird. Maybe I have not saved it. I was expecting error, but anyway. So you can see we got an error. It says add is not defined. And that's right. In app.js, we don't have app function defined or add function defined. Okay, now that's simple, right? We just have to inform app, hey, you are looking for add, but add is not there in the same JS file. It's there in the calc, in a separate module. But how will you do that? And to mention that, we have to use a very powerful function, which is require. And it's not that powerful, but it's powerful behind the scene. So require function, you just have to mention the name of the module or the file in this case. The module name is calc.js. So you have to say calc.js. And then this calc.js belongs to the same folder. And that's the reason we are going to say dot slash. This is not an inbuilt module, right? So we are creating our own in the same directory. So you have to say dot slash and you have to mention the module name. Now, will this work? Let's try. Okay. Oh, we got an error. Now, what is going wrong here? Now, first of all, when you say require, require will simply say, hey, I want calc.js, but then it will not continue that scope after this line. If you want to continue the scope, if you want to reuse that calc.js, let's put that in a separate folder or separate object. We'll say calc. So now what we're doing is we are creating a reference to refer to this particular module, which is calc in this case. This name can be anything, okay? So it's not compulsion that your module name is calc.js, so you have to give calc. It can be anything. It can be ABC. It can be PQR. It doesn't matter. But once you've got the reference, you can simply call this add by saying calc.add. It's that simple, right? Now, if you are coming from other languages like Java or C#, quite simple, right? It's just an object and you're calling a function. Not exactly. Let's try. Let's see what happens. Let's run this code. Again, we got the error. It says calc.add is not a function. That's weird. It's a function, right? We know it's a function. We have getter that function here. See, the thing is, if you remember when we talked about modules in the start of the video, I've mentioned that modules are encapsulated unit, which means encapsulated means these functions will be available in the same module. Of course, for the reason for security. But then I want to use this function outside the module, in some other module. Is it possible? The answer is yes, but how we do that? So we have to mention, see, in this calc.js, if you have 10 functions, maybe you don't want all the functions outside. Now those functions will be used in the same JS file. Okay, but then what if I want to use two functions outside? Now for that, you have to use a very special command, which is module or a statement, module dot exports. So basically you have to export all the function which you want the outside world to use it, right? But then how will you do that? So you have to say modules.export and you have to mention add, what you want to export. So in this case, I'm exporting add. It's that simple. But will this work? I don't know. Let's try. So this is one thing. So if you want this particular function to be used outside, just mention modules.export equal to add. And let's get back here. I hope this will work. Oh, it's not working. It says not a function. Now, in this case, you have to mention the label as well. So you have to say modules.export.add equal to add. So basically, you're assigning this add to this add, which you can use it here. Okay, because if you don't mention this add, then the only solution you have is go back here and don't mention add. So you just use calc as a function because you are exporting add, which goes to the calc here. So this calc become add. I know that's a bit complicated, so that's why I don't use this type of syntax here. So it works. You can see now we're exporting. So the actual syntax we're going to use is you have to say modules.expose.add equal to add so that you can simply use calc.add. It looks comfortable, right, looking at this code now. So basically calc is an object or a reference for the module and you're calling the add function. And then you have to use this. Now, does that mean, okay, so let's try this. Is it working? So it is working. But does this mean that you can have only one function? What if you have multiple functions and you want to export them? In that case, if you have multiple functions, let's say I have one more function here, which is function sub. And this will take, of course, two parameters, a comma b. And here I will say return a minus b. Now, in this case, you have to say module.exports.sub is equal to sub. Now you can use this sub outside. So you can call this function sub and it will work for you. Simple, right? Okay, so this looks cool. Now I want to, so that's one way, right? But then don't you think this writing these modules multiple times is time consuming? So you can skip that. You can simply focus only on exports. So you can say expose.sub and expose.add, even that works. Let's save this and let's verify that if that works. So it is working. So instead of using modules, you can use exports as well. Because, you know, behind the scene, they are mentioning that basically using a shorthand, which is exports are equal to module dot exports. Okay, so this is something which is behind the scene. You don't have to mention that. So even if you say expose dot add, it works. But that's one way. The other way is what if you don't want to use this way? So it's quite simple. You can come back here and you can say exports dot add is equal to function. So you can do this as well. You are exporting here itself. Okay. Now this also works. So you can say we got the output. So basically that's how you create a module in Node.js. It's quite simple, right? So we have seen how to use existing modules. We have seen in this video how to create your own module. and try it out. Create multiple modules. Maybe you can add two numbers. Maybe you can create a module which will calculate the prime number, or it will check the prime number, which will calculate the factorial. Your choice, right? Maybe you can create a module which will write data in database. Try it out and let me know in the comment section if you're able to do that. And if you want to use a modular module, you have to say require. And one thing important, if you want the functions from the module to be used outside, use exports. Very important. Welcome back, aliens. My name is Arvind Reddy, and in this video, we'll talk about file system module in Node.js. See, in the earlier video, we have talked about modules, right? So now we know that if you want to work on a project, you maybe want to create your own modules, and you may want to use some third-party modules. And then we have some modules inbuilt in Node.js as well. And one of them is file system. Now see, when you have a programming language, when you want to work with projects, of course, you need to work with files as well. Maybe you want to write something in a file. Maybe you want to read a file. So how do we do that? Now, thankfully, Node.js has a file system module, which we have talked about. So let's use that file system module in this video, and we'll try to write a file, we'll try to read a file, and let's try to append a file, and maybe we can try to delete as well. Now, I'm not going for any complex example. Let's go for simple examples just to understand how do we use a file system module, and then we'll also see how to use inbuilt modules, right? That's the idea here. Now, first of all, I don't want to use any external library or external code. So let's remove that. This is what we have done in the earlier video. So here I want to use a file system module. Now, first of all, which file I'm going to work with. So if you remember, see, we can work with any file here. We can work with text file, JS file, Java file, doesn't matter, right? So the file should be readable. That's it. Now, if you have this file here, you can see we have this cal.js. Let's read this file. Is it possible? Can we read a programming file? Is it possible? And the answer is yes. And this is one of the assignments which normally you get in colleges or in online competition. How do you read a file? Let's try that. So we'll read this calc file and let's read the content of this file and let's print that on a console. Now for that, we have to first of all get the file system reference or file system module here. And we know if you want to get a file system, set to require, and in the single quote, you have to mention the name of the module, which is FS in this case. Instead of going for file system, they went with FS. That's a smart move. And let's put that in reference, which is FS. So we got FS, which is a file system reference here. And now we want to read a file. Now, how do we do that? So we can say FS dot. Now, if you say FS, you can see we have a list of commands here, a list of functions. We need to use the function, which is read file. Let's use that. Now this read file will take actually three parameters. One of them is optional, I guess. The second parameter is optional. The first parameter you have to mention here is the name of the file. And the name of the file is calc.js. Let's use that. The second parameter, which is optional, which is you have to mention the type of the file or the format of the file or the encoding to be specific. So let's mention the encoding. In this case, the encoding is UTF-8. Let's use that. So you have to check what type of encoding is there in the file and then you have to specify that here. It is optional. If you skip, it will not read the file in a UTF format, but it will not give you error at least. So the first parameter was the file name. The second parameter is the encoding. The third parameter is a callback function. See, what happens is when you say read file, now reading a file will maybe it's a time consuming operation. And then Node.js has a feature which is called non-blocking IO, which means when you say read file, it may take some time, maybe 5 seconds, 10 seconds, maybe 1 second. You don't want to stop the execution. You don't want to pause the execution. So maybe read file process is going on and then in the backend, and then you can continue with the remaining statements. And then, but how do you know that the read file function is done its job? I mean, it will come back, right? So you have to call a callback function. So again, we'll talk about this in detail once we talk about that concept of non-blocking IO. Now, depending upon when you're watching this video, if you're watching this after a long time, that video might have gone to the top of the playlist. So, and it doesn't matter. So let's use a callback function here. So whenever it completes the reading of the file, it will call this function. But then this function will have two parameters. The first one, what if there's an error? Right, so the first parameter will be function or the error, and the second parameter is the data. Now, once you complete reading the file, that data will be stored inside this data variable. Of course, this can be any name, doesn't matter. And then let's do the process here. So basically what we are doing is we are saying, hey, read the file in the UTF format. But then while reading a file, if you get the error, this error will have the information. But what if there's no error? In that case, we'll be having data here. And once you got the data, of course, you can check for the exception. If you can check for the errors. As of now, we don't want to focus on those things. Let's print the data as it is. And how do we print data? It's very simple. You say console.log and let's print the data as it is. Simple, right? So this should work. Let's go back to our console. And here I will say, let's run this file, which is node app.js, enter. And you can see in the output, in the command, in the terminal, we got the code. That's awesome, right? So this, so the content of this cs.js or calc.js is there inside, is there on the console. That's awesome. So that's how you can read a file. But what if you want to write a file? Let's try. So what I will do is, in this case, if I want to write a file, it's very simple. You just have to use a function called write file. The way we have read file, of course, we should have a write file here. Now this write file will take three parameters. The first one is the name of the file. So let's create a new file just for the experiment. So I will say calc.js, oh sorry, calc1.js. The second parameter is the code which you want to write. In this case, I'm writing a code, and that's why I will say console.log. You know, if you heard about this concept where a software can write a software, so that's what you're doing. One code can write another code. I know we are doing a very simple task, but we can do that, right? So here I will print done. So I will just say console.log done. And then, so the third parameter is, after completing this job, after writing the data in a file, if you want to print something or if you want to do some operation, you can do that here. But what if there's an error? So let's also take the handle of the error and let's print something. I will say console.log and we'll say data saved. I mean, of course, you can write anything you want, but let's say data saved. What do you think? Will it work? Let's try. So I'll go back to my node and app.js. You can see we got the output. It says data saved. And interestingly, we got another file. So the file was not there. So your code is actually creating a file. That's awesome. Now, if you jump back to this file, you got calc1.js. So that's right. It is creating a file. And then it is simply writing content. But what if you write content in calc.js? What will happen? I'm writing the same code, which is console.log done in calc.js now, which is already there. So what do you think? When you write that, will it be the last line of this code? Or will it replace the entire code? So that's your question. Pause this video. Write down your comment. Will it replace the entire code or will it append it at the end? So let's try. I hope you have written your answer. Let's try, and you can see say data saved and it is replacing the entire content. That's what write does. So it will wipe up the content and it will write the new content there. But we don't want to write a new content, right? We want to append it if it is existing file. Now in that case, what we can do is, instead of using write file, we can say append file. Okay, now once you say append file, let's try to run this code. Let's see what happens. If I run this code, it says data saved. But what happened to this file? And you can see in this file, we got append. So it is adding the data at the end. That's what we wanted, right? So we got the content. So you can use write file, which will replace the entire content. You can use append file, which is append your data at the end. So that's work. That is working. I just want to check one more thing. How about deleting the data, deleting the file? So let's say we have this calc1.js, which is not required. I want to delete it. So let's go back to the code here, and this time let's delete it. So which function we have to use here? Of course, there should be a function, right? We have function for writing, reading, and for deleting, of course, we should be saying delete, right? But unfortunately, we don't have that method name. So the method name here is unlink. So we have to use unlink, and in this you have to pass a parameter. Now you can guess, of course, the file name should be, the parameter should be the file name, right? So we'll say calc1.js, that's the file name. And then we have to mention the callback function. Now what does callback function is? Now once you delete this file, what you want to execute? So I will say, hey, once you delete a file, in case there's an error, give me the handle so that I can do something with the error. But in this case, I don't want to do anything with the error. I just want to print deleted, that's it. Let's save this and I hope this will work. So let me just say node app.js, enter, and you can see it says deleted. And if you see the file system or the file explorer, we don't have calc1.js anymore. That works. So that's how we use unlink to delete a file. So we have talked about how to create a file, how to open a file, how to read, and then we have seen how to delete a file. I hope you enjoyed the video. Let me in the comment section and do subscribe for further videos. Bye bye. Welcome back, aliens. My name is Devin Reddy, and in this video, we'll talk about Express.js. See, when you want to make a website, when you want to make the entire website using JavaScript, so basically we can use JavaScript everywhere, right? The front end, back end, database, and the framework as well. Now, when you say front end, we have all used JavaScript in the front end, right? And then we can also use JavaScript in the back end, thanks to Node.js. Do we have any framework for web development? See, when you talk about different languages, like we have Python, we have Django framework, we have Java, for that we have Spring framework. Now, when it comes to JavaScript or when it comes to Node.js, the web framework we are going to use here is Express.js. But then why do we need a framework? See, Node.js provides you HTTP module, right, using which you can create a website where a user will send a request and you have to send a response. That works. But when you say you want to build a web application, it will not be having a simple request response thing, right? You will not be saying, hey, server, and server will say, hello, world. That's not how it works. You build a website where you have multiple type of requests. Maybe you are requesting for an image. Maybe you are requesting for a data. Maybe you are sending the data to the server. And also, there will be different type of links, right? So you're requesting a home page, you're requesting a contact page, you're requesting for the data about the user, right? Or you are requesting for all the products from Amazon. So basically, you send a request for a particular endpoints. So for a different type of response which you need, you have to send a different type of request. And on the server side, your function, there will be different functions available, right? And that function will be executed when you send that type of request. And to handle that, it's good to use a web framework. And Express.js is an amazing framework. It is fast and it provides you minimum features so that you can build an amazing website. I mean, I'm talking about the backend part actually. To understand this more, let's go to this website, which is expressjs.com. And if you can see, it says it is fast, unopinionated, minimalistic web framework for Node.js. See, fast, it makes sense. Unopinionated means it will allow you to do whatever you want. See, some of the frameworks, they provide you their own basic feature. They will say, hey, this is how you have to do it. This is how you have to do it. Express says, do whatever you want. So that's the definition, and this is the latest version we can use. So let's start, let's build a simple application using Express.js. Now, when I say simple, I'm literally talking about a base application, a very basic application. So let's go to VS Code, and this is where let's build it. Now to start with, let's write a code which will return you hello world. I mean, that's how you start every time, right? To get started, you have to make sure that you, in your machine, you have Node.js and Visual Studio Code. In this machine, I have Node.js, which is 14.1.0. Let's verify once. I will say node version, and you can see this is the latest version which we got. And you can also have latest version of VS Code. Now, once you have that, let's get started. Now, first of all, if you want to use Express.js or Express framework in your project, so let's first get Express in our code. So let's say const, I want Express in this machine, so in this project. So I will say const Express equal to. Now, how do we get it? So of course, we have seen this function which is require. And in this require, we'll mention Express. We need Express. And as we have talked about this before, you have different modules available in Node.js. Some of the modules are there in the system, and some of the modules are coming from the external server. What about Express? Now, basically, Express is coming from the third-party server, or basically, you can say NPM. Okay, but will this work? Because we have not installed Express on this machine. So before installing it, let's try to run this code and let's see what happens. But even before running, we have to do some more thing. We have to also initialize, we have to also start the Express. And we have to get all the functions, all the properties of it. And the way you can do that is by saying const app. Now in this app, I want Express functions to be there. So I will say Express. This is how you initialize your Express. So we got Express handler, we got Express started. And you can use app to do everything with Express now. But will this work? Let's say save this and go back to your terminal. And this is where I will say node and let's run this code. We'll say app. So we can also say app or you can say app.js, both works. Let's say app and we got error. Let's see what this error is. So this says cannot find a module Express. Oh, that's tricky. Why it is not there? See, the thing is, whenever you work with modules which is coming from the third party, the first thing is you have to install them. And once you install it, it will come in that folder. So the folder which we are working with is Node X. Now in this folder we'll be having the Node modules folder. Okay, so how do we get it? So first of all, let me say npm, the command is, you can use install or you can use I, both works. In fact, if you don't know how to use this, you can just go to npm.js and here you can search for the product which you're searching for, which you want. So I want Express. So when you say search, it will give you the exact match. Now, how do we install it? So there will be a command here. Can you see that it says install npm I Express? So you can mention I or you can mention install, both works. In fact, you can also mention the version number which you want. By default, it will give you this version, but you can also mention the version by specifying @ and the version number. So let me simply say install Express. Let's get the default one and let's say enter. Now it will take some time to download Express from the npm server. Okay, it's done. And if you can see on the left hand side in the node modules, if you expand it, you will see the module of Express. Oh, but hold on, we got not just Express. Express will be here, but with Express you got some other modules as well. Now these other modules are the dependencies for Express. So for your project, Express is a dependency, and for Express, this all modules are the dependencies. That works. Okay, but at least we got Express, right? Now it should not give you any error. Let me just run this code. Node app, and this time you can see we don't have any error. That means Express is there and we can use it now. But then what we want to achieve with Express? As we mentioned, we want to run Hello World. Okay, that's tricky. But then do you think we'll only use Express for Hello World? That's not the case, right? See, whenever you send a request, maybe that request is for the website, maybe that request is for a particular URL. Now in this case, I don't have any website. I just want to run it on localhost with a port number 9000. And whenever I request for this home page, it should return Hello World. That's the first thing we want. And as you can see, we are not getting any data. The next thing is, what if I want to fetch the data about a particular alien? So I want localhost colon 9000 slash alien, because that's how you build a website, right? You'll be having multiple URLs. So when you say enter here, it should give you, let's say, Node 20. That's what we want. And maybe I want a particular alien with an ID 20. So that's how you build a URL. So if you know the concept of REST API, that's how you build a URI. So you mention the website name, then you mention the resource, what you want alien. You have to also pass the ID, which alien you want. So I want the alien with the ID number 20. And this will change, right? And that's why we say it's a dynamic URL, because this will keep changing based on the user. Someone will say, hey, I want 21. Someone will say, I want 28. So when you send a request for 28, your Node.js will use this 28 to fetch the name of the user from the database. Because you are saying 28, Express or Node.js need to search about who is this 28. So it will find a query to database. It will say, hey, I got the ID 28. I want the name. And that's why it's dynamic, because it will change according to users. And maybe you want to pass the query string. So basically when you say 28 like this, you're passing a parameter. But what if you want to pass a query string? Now this thing changes depending upon whatever application you're building. So you can also pass, you can also say question mark, and you can say what? Name is equal to Naveen. I want to search data about Naveen. Or maybe I want to search the ID as 28. So this is the query string, right? So you can use the query string or you can use parameters, that's your choice. I want to do this thing in this video. So let's get started. Now, first of all, you want to start the server because the server is not running yet, okay? So how do we start the server? It's very simple. You simply say app dot, you have to pass listen. It's so simple, right? And then in this listen, you have to mention the port number. You can use any port number. Let me use 9000 here. You can use any available port number. So let me use 9000. And doing this, let me just restart the server. Okay, so you can see it is starting the server. That's why we got that prompt. It will give you that prompt only once. Don't worry. Now, once you've got the server up and running, let's go back to the browser and let's send the request to the homepage. Oh, can you see that? We have not got any error. But we got cannot get slash, but we have not got any error, right? We got something. So your server is up and running, but we don't want this. What we wanted is to get Hello World. How do we do that? See, that's the first thing we want to get hello world. But what we can also do here is, I want to print here if the server is started or not. How do we do that? So what we can do is we can give a comma, and we can pass a function here by saying request response, and here we can say console.log, and we can print running. At least we will see the server is running on the console. Let me stop the server once and let's restart. And you can see it's saying running. That means server is running. So if once the server started, it will print running. But then this will not solve our problem, right? We wanted to print hello world, right? So how do we do that? Now to achieve that, we have to understand the concept of routers. Now what is router or routing? Is in your website, you'll be having multiple links, right? So for different type of link, you will pass different requests, and for that different request, you will be having different response. So how to handle a particular request is decided with the help of routing concept. Okay, so Express has that concept inbuilt, so let's use that. So what we can do is we can specify the routes. So we can say app dot, you can use a method which is get. So in HTTP, we have different methods. We have get, post, put, and delete. We'll talk about other methods in a separate video. How do we use get? How do we use post? How do we use put or delete? Get is simply fetching data from the server. Okay. So when you say post, you are sending data. When you say get, you are receiving data. So let's use get because we want to receive data. And this get will take two parameters. The first parameter is the URL which you are hitting. So basically, when you go to the homepage, you are requesting for this URL which is slash. So here you are requesting for the homepage. You are requesting for slash. But once you send this request, what will happen? You have to execute the function, right? So you will say function here, and this function will take two parameters and you have to execute something. So what I will execute is I want to print hello world, right? So we can do that. It's very simple. You will say console.log and you will print hello world. Simple, right? Okay, let's verify, will this work? So let me stop the server, let's start again, and go back to the browser. Okay, once we refresh the page, you can see the request, we have still not got the response yet. But if you go to console, you can see we got hello world. Oh, we were expecting hello world on the browser, right? Something went wrong. Okay, what went wrong is when you send a request and when you say I want a response, you should not be saying console.log, right? Because console.log will print on the console. We want to send response on the browser. In that case, we'll not be saying console.log. We have to use a special object. If you can see, we have two objects here, which is request and response. Request object will have data which is going from client to server, and response object will have the data from which is going from the server to client. So I want to send data from server to client, so we have to say response dot, the method name is send, and then you will send hello world. This should work. Okay, let's go back and refresh. Oh, we got hello world there. Okay, even before refreshing, because it was sending request and it was waiting for the response. Okay, so we got hello world. So we have achieved our first thing. We got hello world. But then we also wanted to have this thing, right? When you say request for alien, it should give you data about alien. How do we do that? And for that, we can create a separate function. So we can say app.get, and this time we are requesting for alien, and it should execute a function when you request for alien. We'll say req res, it will execute, and it will say response.send will send a response as welcome back alien. That's it. Let's see if that works. Let me just restart the server once. Go back here, refresh. Oh, it is still not working. Is it because of the slash? Let's try that. Oh, so I was missing slash there. Okay, but we got welcome back alien, right? That's how you specify the routing. So for different URLs, you will have different functions which is working for it. Okay, what I also want here is I don't want to print welcome back alien. What I want is if you pass a particular alien by saying 20, I want to return Naveen, 21 Kiran, 22 Harsh. So based on what you send, I want to send that data. Now, of course, I will not write the entire logic, because for that you have to write if else, right? So if it is 20, you have to return with Naveen. If it is 21, Kiran. If it is 22, you have to return Harsh. So that's the if condition you have to complete. Okay, that's your assignment. What I will do is, I will just show you how do you accept a dynamic URL. So for that, I will say again, app.get, and in this, I will specify alien. Now, since I want a dynamic URL, I will specify 20, and then I will say function request response, and then we can respond it with hey Naveen. Okay, this should work now. Let's try. It's running, refresh. Can you see that we got hey Naveen? But the problem is, the moment you change this URL, when you say 21, it's not working. It's because we are still specifying 20 there. We are not specifying 21. We want to make it dynamic because this will change. So in that case, you can hold that in a particular holder, a placeholder, which is ID in this case, or the param. So instead of using, now we got ID, right? So we can fetch this data. So I will say const, I will say ID is equal to, how do you fetch it? So we can use a request object. Request object has something called as params. And in this param, you can specify ID. So whatever you mention here, the same thing you will assign here, okay? So if it is ID, ID, AID, AID, that's your choice. And then you can use this ID, you can, now you can use if condition and you can check, but I will not do that. I will simply print this ID as it is, just to show that it is dynamic. And let's stop this running, refresh. And you can see that even if we say 21, it works. Even if we say 20, it works. So whatever data you pass in the address bar, it will print on the page. But that's not what we wanted, right? We wanted to have a different code. That's what you will do. And the hint is, you have to use if else. You have to check for the value of the ID. Okay, that works. But what if you want to specify with the help of maybe the query string? Maybe ID is equal to 20. Now, what will change here is, you can see it is still going for alien because that's a request. You are passing the query string. So you can change this alien as it is. Here, what you can do is, you can get that name. So you can say const name is equal to, we are passing name or ID. Okay, we are passing an ID. So with the ID equal to request dot query, because this time you're going for query, not params. You just specify ID. Now, once you got the ID, you can come back here and you can say welcome back alien. And you can also mention the ID here. Restart the server. So you can say refresh. So you can see we have worked with both now. We can use the params, which is slash 20. Which is mostly used for the REST API. But if you want to work with the browser way, you know, when you go to Google and when you search something, example, if you search for Java, if you can see google.com/search?q=Java. This is the query string. Right? That's how it works. If you search for Telusko, that's how it works. Search, and then it will search for the things. Okay, so that's how we use query string and param. I hope you enjoyed this. But there's one issue I know you might be thinking about this, is every time you make a simple change, you have to restart the server, right? See, if you don't want to do that, you have to install one more module, which is NodeMon, using which you can actually, you don't have to restart the server, you simply have to save. It will automatically restart the server behind the scene. So yeah, that's much from this video where we have used Express.js to create some URL mapping in Node.js. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed. Let me in the comment section and do subscribe for other videos. Bye-bye.